Al Harlow in the Kevin Unscripted studio. This is pretty amazing. Thank you for coming out.
It's good to be with you, Kevin.
Absolutely. And especially coming out to the studio and being able to experience, you know, the whole experience of what Kevin Unscripted is about.
It's fantastic. When we're out in the country, it's nice and quiet and there's blue sky above us.
Yeah. Yeah. You even get the dogs barking in the background a little bit. Yes. Gives it the atmosphere.
We've met the dogs.
Well, I'll do an introduction to you for everybody who's watching, and then we can go from there. One of the things I thought would be kind of cool, which I'm going to try, is we're going to have a little background music that I think people might recognize. Spaceship Superstar.
Oh my goodness.
We're going to try that out.
They're playing my song.
Yeah. Here we go. Oh, it's starting. So, Al Harlow is a Canadian musician and one of the original members of the iconic rock band Prism. Since the mid-1970s, he has been a driving force in the music industry, producing and releasing numerous albums with Prism, including their biggest hit, Spaceship Superstar, which we're listening to right now, along with other notable hits that include Don't Let Him Know, Take Me Away, Night to Remember, and Young and Restless. The band's music combines elements of progressive rock, hard rock, and pop, resulting in a unique, unforgettable sound. Prism has undergone several changes in band members over the years, but Al has remained steadfast in his commitment to creating and performing music that resonates with fans across generations. Their original lineup includes Mitchell, Alan Harlow and John Hall, Rocket Norton and Ron Tabak. After the release of their debut album, Tabak was replaced by Henry Small, who remained with the band until 1981. In the early 1980s, Prism made a significant shift in their musical style, moving towards a more commercial radio-friendly sound, and this resulted in some band members leaving. But despite the change, Prism continued to achieve commercial success throughout the decade, releasing several popular albums and hit songs such as Don't Let Him Know. In 1987, the band released their final album to date, Jericho. However, they have since performed and continued to tour and perform, with Al Harlow being the only remaining original member. Their impact on Canadian music scene has been significant, with many considering them to be one of the most influential and successful rock bands to come out of the country. Prism's achievements are all the more impressive when reviewed alongside those of other Canadian artists like Bryan Adams, Kim Mitchell, and the Guess Who have also made their mark on the international music scene. It's worth noting that Prism has played at the Lido Theatre now 3 times, cementing their place in the hearts of the fans in the area. Al Harlow's contributions to Prism and the Canadian music industry as a whole has been invaluable, and his induction into the BC Entertainment Hall of Fame is a testament to his impact and talent. So there you go.
My goodness.
How was that? A little long-winded, but I think there was a lot there to cover.
I can't follow. It sounds like you're talking about somebody else. How do I follow that?
Well, you guys have been around for such a long period of time that, I mean, it's hard to try and condense absolutely everything that the band has gone through. I mean, can you tell us a little bit about the earlier days in the music industry and how you got started with Prism?
Well, yeah, and Prism wasn't really our start. When we were kids, we had a band called The Seeds of Time, which essentially was the lineup that became Prism. But we discovered a singer named Ron Tabak, who had just a crystalline, beautiful voice. He could sing ballads and rock songs and just a sweet guy. And so with that combination, we started making records. And in those days, the holy grail was to get a recording contract, the way the Beatles did, you know.
Yeah.
And that was the dream, you know. It's kind of like, you know, young boys dreaming of being hockey stars, you know, that kind of thing, right? So that was a common, understandable way of kids getting started. And then it turns into a career.
Wow. Well, one of the things that you mentioned even last night in part of your performance is that Brian Adams, at the age of 17, had written a song with Prism that was in one of your albums.
Yeah.
And the longevity for it to have been, you know, played even still, what was that, about 46 years later? Now, I mean,
yeah,
that's quite a testament, not only to, I guess, the music that was played in that genre, but also a lot of the people that, like you, we were saying earlier, the Who and Brian Adams and Kim Mitchell, that have been, you know, influenced and part of Prism as a band itself. Like, how did that start out with, you know, interacting and being on the same stage and, you know, getting to know a lot of these other people that are staples in the Canadian music scene?
Well, going right back to the time when we were all burgeoning and you know, getting our start. And yes, you mentioned Brian. Well, you know, I knew Brian before it all happened, and you know, he was an enthusiastic young songwriter, great young singer, and we were all just kind of finding our way around the Vancouver area.
Yeah.
And we realized later that growing up in Vancouver, there was a very strong sense of community among the musicians. Like, you don't always get that. Sometimes it's very competitive, you know what I mean? Like, Gee, my little band has to become successful and these other guys are just competing for the same, you know, piece of the pie. But in Vancouver, it wasn't like that. Like, Bill Henderson of Chilliwack and, you know, Randy Bachman came out to after the Guess Who to put together Brave Belt, which became BTO, Bachman Turner Overdrive. And Heart, the band Heart, had their start out of Vancouver. Anyway, we were all of us were friends. The guys in Trooper, Ray and Smitty, and so there was just a feeling of encouragement. You know, like the phone would ring and someone would say, "Hey, we're in the studio. We're doing our first record. Do you want to play some guitar on it?" You know, and then of course your response would be, "Yeah, sure,
of course."
Yeah, and so that really helped. And I remember Brian in that context, you know, like He'd say, "Hey, I just wrote a song. You want to hear it?" Sure.
Absolutely.
It ends up on the album, you know.
Wow. So you guys were pretty much cheering each other on as you started to become established and a little bit more known. And, you know, some of the hits that were starting to get knocked out of the park, it was more of, I think, a support system that everybody was cheering each other on with, instead of that little bit of a, I don't know what you would even call that, really. I guess you think it'd be a bit of a jealousy factor in the fact that other bands were making it and some weren't. And
that's possible, but I mean, the word competitive probably captures that idea. But excuse me. For example, I mean, not that the world began, you know, with our generation. I mean, before us, there was a rock and roller named Buddy Knox who broke out of Vancouver and stuff. But say when Heart and Trooper and my good friend Nick Gilder of Sweeney Todd, they started putting out records. Well, that meant, oh my goodness, we better get it together here. You know what I mean? So 6 months later, it's your turn. You know, so it was even that was encouraging. Even the competitive, if you want to call it competitive, you know, we were cheering each other on. But then we all realized, hey, we got to do this.
Add a little bit of motivation.
Yeah, let's get this thing moving, boys. Yeah. You know, we've been playing these teen dances and, you know, jumping in a van and driving around the countryside and playing shows. Now it's time to hit the studio and get serious.
Well, how has that changed over the years with the industry, you know, switching pretty much from record deals and whatnot to like the digital era? Especially transitioning over into how it is now, where, you know, Spotify and Amazon Music and everything is kind of the place where people get their music from. That's quite a transition from pretty much vinyl all the way up until how it is now. Like, how has that been to be able to adapt and kind of go with?
And full circle back to vinyl again, yeah.
Yeah, pretty much, isn't it? Isn't that odd how that works?
Well, there's so much spoken of this. Now, excuse me, if young people are watching this right now, they won't have a living memory of, I liken it to the Hollywood system of filmmaking, you know, like that generation of old Hollywood, you know, kids, you know, boys and girls, they dreamed of being a movie star. Well, of course, if you want to do that, you have to be a serious actor and not worry about how famous you are. Just get your craft together, you know?
Yeah.
And then you had to go to where these gigantic studios and gigantic cameras and huge lighting systems. Now you can make a movie in your backyard, right? So it's the same kind of thing. I mean, when I was starting off, excuse me, I mean, the demo tape was the coin of the realm, you know? Can you find a way to make a little recording that sounds like it was done in a studio?
Yeah.
And that's your calling card. And then the record company would sit in their office and give it a listen and see if you had the potential. And then maybe you'd get allowed to go into a great big recording studio. Well, now, of course, you can make an album in your basement, you know, because of the technology.
Yeah.
So if you just, you know, transfer that thought all the way through the marketing side and the exposure side and all that, like, yeah. And, you know, there were probably pluses and minuses in what we shall refer to as the record label era, you know? So you had to get signed, you know, an A&R guy, you know, artist and repertoire, an A&R guy had to come out and watch your band play at a dance or a club or something and decide if you're good enough or if you have some songs and all that, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Everything was an audition against an audition and, you know, that kind of thing. But that was okay in with respect to the fact that it was kind of a filtration system. Like, you had to be good to get that far. You know what I mean? And so it was a kind of trial by fire thing. As we know, in those days, the Billboard Top 100 chart, or, you know, the whatever your radio station is, you know, the top 40,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's a finite number. You know, top 40, that means there's 40. Top 100 in Billboard, that means there's only room for 100. You know what I mean?
Yeah, in comparison to the pool of talent that they're trying to draw all those numbers out of.
Yeah, so somebody said this, a wiser person than I said this. So now, of course, we're living in the modern world where you can actually make a really good, you know, it still takes skill. You have to have the talent to, well, hopefully, not auto-tune your vocals to the point where you sound like a robot. Yeah. But, you know, let's assume that you have to be good. You have to be able to write a good song and sing it and play it. And, well, we'll assume so anyway. And but somebody said, you know, the good news is we can all make records in our parents' basement. The bad news is everybody's making records in their, you know what,
yeah,
I mean?
Exactly.
So
yeah.
I heard last week, I don't know where this statistic came from, but I heard last week that there are 1,000 albums per day being released around the world.
Wow.
How do you even?
Wow.
No one can track that.
Well, so that's a little bit of a quality control in itself now, because if you want to be able to kind of break free out of that overwhelming amount of talent now getting into, you know, jockeying for position, you're going to have to be pretty much the top 10 or 100 just by the nature of being able to kind of be recognized as...
That's right, yeah, yeah.
Good talent.
The talent should prevail. It should float to the top, and the audience... it's always a game of the audience has to find you.
Yeah.
Well, once upon a time, that meant a quarter-page ad in Rolling Stone magazine. You know, you find
them. Or signing a record deal, but I think, from what I understand, a lot of people started to get a little bit... just some disdain with it because of the control.
Oh, well, yes, that's the downside, yeah. And there were great record labels to be signed with, and that doesn't mean to say the biggest either. We were with Capital EMI, remember that? Capital EMI?
Yeah, yeah.
Names like RCA, Warners,
yeah.
You know, Sony, remember those names? Well, forget that, that's all gone now. But yes, of course, you were certainly at the mercy of the record company executives and so forth. And sometimes they would even pick and choose. They would say, okay, we got a budget of such and such, you know, summer's coming, you know, all the beach hits, everyone's got their radio on the beach. And then, oh, here comes Christmas now, we have to get ready for that. And yeah, a lot of talent was left at the side of the road because the labels themselves were picking and choosing, even amongst their own rosters. They would pick and choose as to who to get behind and put the marketing behind. Now that's kind of the dark side of what we used to call the record business. But now all of that is public domain, you know?
Yeah.
You get it out there and you just hope that people find you. And if enough people find you, then it flows to the top. And that's what they call going viral. So it's up to it's really hands on. It's like the home game, you know?
Yeah.
Like the musicians are left to their own devices to get it out there and have their street team market it. And, you know, and then the audience itself has to come and find you, you know? And, you know, that's kind of a romantic way of, a direct way of doing it. Of course it is. But, I mean, from what we just said, you could take 5 minutes and kind of put it on a sheet of paper and say, here's the pluses and here's the minuses. So you have to accept, you know, the world that you're living in. But yeah, it was a lot more organized and controlled. I think you used the word, the quality control. It was a quality control system when the record labels dominated, you know, the era of the suits. now it's a free for all now.
I think they were able to kind of have a bit of built-in quality control because there was a requirement for you to actually be someone that could write or produce your own music, play an instrument, form a band.
Yep.
There was a little bit more of an art form and skill that went with it. Whereas mm-hmm. it seems like right now with a lot of the technology, you pretty much see somebody who knows how to sing and then you can hire just about everybody else, right? It's all automated. And you see that on, you know, some of the shows like America's Got Talent and whatnot. They're pretty much, the auditions are typically the singers.
Oh, yeah.
You don't see the makeup of a whole band and how that's put together with them writing their own material, you know, and forming a little bit of that band or that team together that's going to, you know, be representative in their music. It's just mm-hmm. a singer mm-hmm. That you have now. And I think that's why we've lost, it seems like anyways, the feel is we've lost a little bit of that, I don't know, the feel, the genre, and the 90s music in your era seems to, be crossing over different generations because that is the difference, I think, between a lot of the music now and then what you got back in the 80s and the 90s. Mm-hmm. You had to be able to play, you had to be able to perform, mm-hmm. and now that's, you got ChatGTP to be able to write your music.
Writing your next song, yeah.
And the equipment to put it together.
Well, all of the above, yeah. And you know, we could look at that from different aspects. Like when I was a kid, yes, you formed the band and you wrote your own songs. I mean, I was just on the crest of that generation where I didn't even, when you're a kid, you're not editing, you're not reflective. You're just out there swinging your arms as wildly as you can, you know. So, but I thought that writing songs was just part of the package. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We already had Lennon and McCartney. We already had Jagger and Richard. You know what I mean? Bob Dylan was already, writing everybody's songs for them. So it never even occurred to me. You know, my job is to write songs. Now, of course, you have to be able to do it, So not being a musician and being a songwriter are two separate skill sets, But anyway, I guess I was blessed enough to, have a bit of common sense and I could, put together song ideas and manage to, get through that.
When you're writing a song, how do you be able to capture the sound and the essence of a band without all your songs actually sounding the same?
Well, now you're talking about today's world. Yeah, because you got GarageBand, Logic 10 has a whole library of drum sounds and even little guitar riffs. So So when my little gang and I were coming up, you drove the neighbors nuts by rehearsing in your parents' basement.
Yeah.
And then you went out and played the local Friday night teen dance, kids, and that's how you started. So we made all our mistakes in public, I mean, I learned how to sing through a cheap little PA system, with 350 of our best friends from school standing there either clapping or cheering or laughing at us, And now, but see, here's the difference. Young people today, those avenues don't necessarily exist, So they're sitting at home with all the technology and writing and creating music, but they haven't gone out there and fallen flat on their faces, in a local pub, nightclub, well, we used to say teen dances, whatever it was, right?
Yeah,
That kind of stuff. So yeah, we learned in public, we learned by playing live. And that element has been kind of removed. So young people can go from zero, from just deciding, gee, I want to do this, to like this year's Junos was a perfect example of that, to having a hit video, a hit song, all this kind of stuff. And they've never done a show yet. They haven't been in front of 1,000 people.
Yeah, and, unreal.
And we can extrapolate that even further. So to get up on a stage with an acoustic guitar or, you know, whatever, you know, what we call real-time instruments, a real set of drums, you know, someone actually playing the keys and playing guitars and basses and stuff, and, you know, versus quantizing and, you know, auto-tuning and all that, singing into a microphone with no auto-tuning, I recommend that you cultivate those skills.
Yeah.
It'll come in handy when you have to play in front of people.
Well, there's, I'm sure, difference between honing the song and playing it over and over and over, like let's say in a studio, to now all of a sudden you're in front of a crowd.
Yeah.
And there's a performance element that you need to bring into it.
Oh, yeah.
There's a whole lot more of a stage presence that you got to be able to bring with you instead mm-hmm. of just sitting in front of a mic and now playing like what you're doing in the studio.
Yeah.
In front of an audience.
Yeah.
With all the equipment and the lights. And
I liken this. This is a world premiere for me. I've never voiced this. But when you go to the circus and there's the high wire act, you know, and they're twirling and they're letting go of the swing and doing a somersault and then the other person catches them, or they got the pole and they're walking. There's a certain amount of danger watching people on a stage. You know, what if the guitar player breaks a string, you know, yeah. like which is going to happen, you know?
Yeah.
What if the drumsticks fall apart and everything, you know? And so the audience, they realize that's part. There's a slight element of things could go wrong here.
Yeah.
And this is for real. We're not hiding behind, it's not pre-recorded music, you know, like we're banging away on our instruments. And that's part of the thrill of live, watching people live, you know?
Yeah, a little bit of it actually showed yesterday too, I think. Yeah,
oh, did it?
Well, remember the mic, I think, with Mike. And then you brought it right to the forefront and made it a little bit humorous because you're telling Mike to get Mike his mic.
Oh, yes.
And you brought that right in because he wasn't able to hear himself. So that's a skill that, I mean, a lot of people would have froze under that kind of pressure. But you took that awkwardness right out of it and just kind of blended it right into the whole, you know, presentation and act. I mean, that's something that's got to be a little bit tricky to be able to just kind of roll with spontaneously.
You just said it. You have to roll with it, you know. And yes, this will all be in my book. But
oh, yeah.
under the heading of what could possibly go wrong here, well, of course it will. And I must say this too, because we've all heard about big superstars canceling shows, you know, because they don't feel well or they got a case of the flu or, you know, or whatever else, right? But the old great bluesman, the English bluesman, Long John Baldry, who was a good friend of mine, and Lord rest his soul, he's no longer with us. But we talked about this once, and he said, the show does go on. It's the old vaudevillian motto, the show must go on. So even if you do have a sore throat, or you know, it's going to happen, right? But if you get up on that stage anyway, and it's happened to me, it's happened to, you know, people I know, sometimes you can't even sing, I'm not feeling well. But if you get up on that stage and you say, folks, you know, I've got a sore throat, I can't sing, I'm not going to be able to hit it tonight, you know, but we're here, let's have fun, let's do this.
Yeah.
And the audience, they're with you. They'll forgive you for
they'll
that.
They'll support you.
And let's do this. And now they think you're a hero for showing up.
Yeah.
And of course, we want to get paid.
Yeah.
So, you know, the show goes on. So, yeah, all that. I mean, we've had amplifiers blow up and, you know, drum kits fall over and microphones go down and all that. But, yeah, you just roll with it and the audience is on your side. You know what I mean?
Well, that is probably part and parcel. I mean, the technical issues, just being able to adapt and overcome. It shows. And mm-hmm. people, you're right. I think a lot of people realize what's going on. They're not really stupid.
Well, sure.
And you're going to build, I think, more loyal fan base when you're able to do that and show the commitment to the show.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really cool. So, you know, that element now when it comes to performing live now, mm-hmm. especially for some of these artists that are trying to get into it and form a band, I'm sure you've been asked countless times, like, what would be one of the more insightful pieces of advice that you might want to give somebody that is getting into that element where they need to break past that threshold of, you know, stage fright.
Mm-hmm.
Being able to take on, I guess, that whole other dynamic and element of now you've written your material, you're at a point now where you want to go out into the public and present it.
Mm-hmm.
Are there things that you've learned along the way to be able to kind of, you know, overcome some of those, I don't know, threshold insecurities, maybe nervousness, honing the performance, so to speak?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess, well, some of these things you can't really systematize or you know, put into a how-to book. But yeah, to look for opportunities to get out there and get your music to people for real. You know, as we were saying earlier, before the lights and cameras came on, you know, your average person will look at a performer and say, oh man, I could never do that. You know, I'm okay in a room having a conversation with somebody, but don't ask me to public speak. I can't talk
exactly,
to 450 people in a room or 4,000, you know, don't put me in that position in front of a microphone, you know, that kind of thing. And you always get your Uncle Bob who has to give a speech at a wedding, you know, testing, is this thing on? Hey, I don't need no microphone. No, yes, Uncle Bob, you do need the microphone and you need to learn how to use it and speak into, you know, that kind of stuff, right? So, yeah, learn your craft. So I would say, you know, if I was 19 years old and looking to get into this kind of stuff, and don't get all self-conscious about wanting to be famous or say, like, learn your craft, like, fall in love with what you're doing, you know? And it's just human nature. There's always been somebody who says, okay, I got it figured out. I know what a hit song is. Oh, do you? Well, tell the rest of us and then we'll all know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
What's that formula?
Yeah, the formula. There's always been that, right? As you know, of course. And even way back in the early rock and roll days, there would be some guy out there who ran a radio station or ran a corporate string of radio stations. I know what a hit is. You know? And I will say there was a guy at Capitol Records in L.A., the big round building, you know, the Capitol Records building. His name was John Carter, and he produced Tina Turner and Sammy Hagar, and he produced a couple albums for us, too. I miss him. He was a great guy. He was this doesn't really affect what I'm saying, but he was a producer who worked for Capitol, so he was in at all the meetings, you know, the marketing meetings and the signing meetings and all that kind of stuff. So he was part of the corporate structure. And he took me aside one day and he says, you know, all these guys who say they can spot a hit and they can spot talent and all this, that's nonsense. They're just guessing. He says, we're all guessing. Nobody knows, right?
Well, that's I think, got a whole lot of truth to it, doesn't it?
Well, yeah, because on the one hand, sure, we can all identify formulas. We can say, oh, have you heard this new singer? You know, she or he sounds like this and a combination of that. Sure, we can all glue together what we think we know. And we say, well, it's sort of like this and it's sort of like that. Well, now you're talking what's already happened, right?
Yeah.
But someone next week or next year is going to take us all by surprise with a brand new sound and some brilliant song that we hadn't thought of. So it's dangerous to think that we can. And then now today, of course, there's software that can tell you what a hit is. So I would say that all those human elements where you've got the know-it-all experts who think they know what a formula is for success, which may or may not work. But first of all, the main danger is you're talking about stuff that's already happened. And so I remember my friends in the British band Ultravox, and this happened to us too, where we were changing labels. You know, we were going from this record company and we were going to sign with a new one. And so in the case of my dear friends in London, in England, Ultravox, they were talking to the big labels and they said, okay, well, we see you guys as the next whatever it was. You know, we see you guys as the next Roxy Music or the next Elton John. And they said, we're not the next anything. We're us. If you don't want to sign us for what you see right here and what you're hearing with our music, bye. You know, you're not going to mold us into, you know. You know,
well, that and I don't think people are able to predict it because it's odd what song, like you said, will take off and resonate with a lot of different people. And how do you predict that in a way? Because then obviously you're just producing, I guess, so to speak, boy bands, aren't you? I think you're just kind of going with something you think is going to end up being a hit and you're just cut and paste.
Well, yeah. Yeah. And you're chasing what happened last week. So
So if now you have a song, and I'm sure you've run into this quite a few times, how do you know if you actually have something that you think is going to end up being resonate? Like, do you use that through like releasing singles and then kind of see what takes and which one is going to be a little bit better, you know, perceived versus what you think you have, you know, in front of you? I'm sure you think, oh, this is a really good song and it doesn't do very well. And then another one that you don't think is going to do very well does the exact opposite. It turns into maybe a hit. Right? Have you run into those scenarios?
Like, see, we're writing the book right now, right? Well, this will be the Kevin and Al encyclopedia of, you know, there are books written on that, like the universal response to great music. There are books written, right? Like, why are we still listening to Beethoven? Why? Why are we still listening to, you know, I mean, you know, someone's going to go home tonight and put on an old Frank Sinatra record and it's going to move them to tears, you know? So, yeah. The great, I mean, we've been talking about record companies, right? Which is now pretty much a lost art. I mean, in the States now there's Republic Records and they're signing everybody. And so, of course, if they're going to be successful, they're going to have ears, you know, A&R ears that can spot something that the public are going to love. You know what I mean? But you use the word resonate, and that's what it is. Does it resonate in your heart? Does it move you? You know, God invented music. You know, the first songs were hymns, you know. Yeah. So does it move your heart? Does it stir your spirit and your soul? So that's the million-dollar question, right? So the great A&R people of record company history, David Geffen, John Hammond Sr., Clive Davis, these were guys who could ask the same questions that we all ask each other. Gee, I got a song. Do you think it's a hit? But those guys actually had the answers. Like, for some reason, those names that I just mentioned, they had some kind of antennae sticking out of their head where they realized that people are going to love this song, and they were right. So that's a talent.
Well, they're, I'm sure, able to use an experience or a point of view or something that kind of hit them.
Yeah.
Where they were able to put it into music in a way where they were able to articulate and express it in a way that they knew was going to, you know, be a hit with everybody else.
Yeah, right.
That's got to be a bit of a very unique, I think, talent to have. Like, how do you put that into words and then the tune? Like, and I've always actually wondered that. I mean, what's your approach on it? Do you focus on the lyrics? Do you focus maybe more on the melody and then, you know, have the lyrics fit? What do you find for inspiration? Like, do you have something that you found works for you the best? Like, your approach?
Yeah. And it's going to be different with each idea, each song. Sometimes a great title comes to you. You know what I mean? You mentioned some of the some of our stuff you were mentioning. Last night we were going to play. We can't play all our songs every night, you know. So we mix it up. So we're doing two nights at the Lido Theater. So tonight we're going to play a few songs that we did not play last night, you know. But you mentioned I'm just pulling this out of thin air right now. But one of the songs that we were going to play last night that we didn't was a song that Brian Adams and Jim Vallance wrote for us. It was called Don't Let Him Know.
I did mention that earlier.
Yeah. And that was a hit for us around the world. It was like number one in Japan and all Australia and all that kind of stuff. And so who knew? But there was just a title. I could phone those guys and ask them, was that one of those songs where the title came first? In that case, I would probably guess not, because it's not a striking title, like in a bridge over troubled water, you know,
yeah,
or Hey Jude, or, you know what I mean? But it could be a little snippet of melody comes first, you know, something like that. You know, as you mentioned, Jim Vallance, by the way, wrote Spaceship Superstar. So, you know, what was the genesis of that idea?
Yeah, what was the spark for that, eh? That built that whole song in around it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, I guess that's unique to each artist, isn't it?
Yeah, and then sometimes the music comes first. And Jeff Lynne of ELO fame, the way he works is that he'll get exciting music, generally speaking. Now, that can change for everybody, right? And he'll go into the studio and just record a song that doesn't yet have any lyrics. but he'll get an exciting track and an exciting arrangement. And then he'll sit down and say, okay, now I guess we need a melody and a title, you know, you know, and then somebody and somebody else will start with, don't get me started here. We can talk all day. But a friend of mine who used to be a tech for Prism, he started off as a guitar tech and he was into road management and stuff. And he went from Prism and then to Bruce Springsteen's band. He ended up his career with, he was Jimmy Page's guitar tech in the end. But he spent many years with Elton John's band, Davey Johnson, the guitar player.
Yeah.
And Elton John, he looked after all of his technical needs. And so he was in the studio when they were recording, when Elton John was recording his like Too Low for Zero and some of his biggest stuff, you know, Sad Song, Say So Much. So my buddy, Carter, a different Carter, yeah, Gene LaLoge was his name. We called him Carter. And so he would come back from England and he would, and I was teaching songwriting at Capilano University back in those days. And he'd say, oh, Bernie Taupin and Elton John gave me these lyric sheets. They just gave them to me. And he says, here, go ahead. You know, he would give them to me. And
wow.
So he told me that, now, again, song by song, it could be different. You could walk in with a finished song. You could walk in with something that's almost finished or needs an arrangement. You could arrange it on the spot, you know, with the musicians and everybody in the room. You know, there's a hundred ways of doing this. But Gene LaLoge told me that he saw more than once, that Bernie Taupin would walk in and put lyrics in front of Elton as he's sitting at the piano. And Elton would read it and go, oh, wow, hey, that's cool, you know, and he'd just start.
Oh, you just start putting it together.
Yeah. So the lyric sheets that I was given were those scratch sheets.
Wow.
And Elton would pull out his pen and cross out lines and put in a different word, or he'd put a check mark beside one verse. So Taupin would give him all these options. So there might be 14 verses. But there's only room in a 3-4 minute song for 2 or 3 verses, you know what I mean? And so these were like rough sheets, and Elton would cross out a line and
jeez.
And they'd
so he would pretty much real time just like through the feel of something just start playing with it and see what kind of came out through melody and put it all together.
Yeah And so
wow.
So Gene told me that at one point they took a dinner break, you know. Somebody sent out for hamburgers, you know. So everyone's taken a half an hour to have dinner. But Elton himself, I've never met him. I don't know. I'm just, you know, wasn't hungry. So he sat behind his piano and started playing, I guess that's why they call it the blues. And like within 20 minutes, it was done. Like
really?
That the record that we hear now, yeah.
Wow.
Everyone put down their hamburgers and walked out and they played it and it was done in like 20 minutes.
Jeez. I wish. Hey, yeah. I bet you a lot of people had wish they had that ability to just kind of throw things together and
But you know,
let it speak to.
But I'm still trying to answer your question because you said what would the advice be for young people inspired? Like inspiration comes first, right?
Yeah.
And so, okay, how do you cultivate that enthusiasm and that inspiration? And so my core advice would be true to what resonates with you. You know what I mean? Like if you're excited about an idea that you have, you know, cultivate that. That's what it's all about. You know, just follow that muse. And, you know, some of that could be divine inspiration, you know? And I think it was this year's Grammys. It was Song of the Year. And what's his name? Beato. He does his online podcast show. And they were talking about the craft of what goes into writing a song, which is what we're talking about here. And we are now in an era where these experts who know what a hit formula is, remember?
Yeah.
And so
Nickelback. I don't want to throw them in there, but apparently they've got the formula.
So we'll defer to their advice. But once upon a time, you know, some people write a complete song all by themselves. I mean, in my own modest way, I've done that. I love being part of a songwriting partnership because you can bounce off ideas and, you know, the weaker ones get thrown into the garbage can and then someone's going to say something which is going to give you a better idea and so it should spiral upwards, you know, and you end up with the best of the collaboration. But they say now you do have all these algorithm experts. So if you see one song with 13 composer names listed, chances are pretty good that all 12 or 13 of those people did not actually write the song.
Yeah.
They were just in the room advising as to what the formula is, right? And so that's the problem we have now with young songwriters, because some poor little songwriter will sit there and saying, "Oh, okay, I'll do whatever you say. Oh, you're telling me that I should have the chorus come here and I should repeat that 8 times and then this should happen and then, you know, at 30 seconds this should happen." So now you're destroying the inspiration, right? You're putting it into the formula, and it comes out sounding like a cuckoo clock, you know?
Yeah.
Okay, now we'll auto-tune the whole thing, and then, you know, at 1 minute and 37 seconds, this has to happen.
You have to have the melody or the chorus.
Yeah, it's like those TikTok videos where you've got 3 other videos in the corner just to grab people. It's like you're trying to hypnotize a monkey or something. So my advice to young people would be avoid all that garbage and just be true to your heart. And if you come out with a song that resonates and moves other people's hearts, you've probably got something pretty good.
I think so. I think you're spot on with that, because any of the people that I've talked to, not just with musicians, but it's also, you know, crossing over into comedy, you know, and to some extent, the very little bit amount of poetry that I know of, one of the I think relatable elements in it all is that it's relatable. They're just taking, I think, a point of view or an experience or an emotion that they have, and they're able to kind of explain it in a way that a lot of other people are able to relate to. And it's got, I think, the flow and the sound to it where it draws people in, and now they're actually engaged. And that's probably one of the reasons why you have these hits take right off, is because they're speaking to something that a lot of people feel and can relate to.
Absolutely.
Probably why, you know, love songs are so popular, is because they're able to actually hit on that one feeling that every human has and explain it in a way where they're like, "Oh yeah, that's explaining how I feel." And it's very hard to try and actually put that into words, especially a song that has that flow, right? I think that's probably, you know, what you're saying. I would imagine that's probably one of the more important things, is stay true to not only yourself, but what's the passion and what's the reason for you wanting to get into it? And if you can explain that, it's probably going to translate into material.
Yeah, precisely.
And that's the art, isn't it?
It is very much.
Being able to express that in your own way.
Certainly, yes. And as you say, comedy, film, graphics, painting, music, the audience, someone's going to say, "That song not only speaks to me, it also speaks for me." Like,
I
felt that way, and that song is making me feel that way again, you know? Love, they say 85% of, oh, here we go with the formula. 85% of, dare we say, hit songs, or now we're talking about, you know, like a hit where? I mean, there's charts everywhere now. Amazon is a chart now. It's crazy. But, you know, songs that resonate with people are love songs. 85% of songs, you know, reach out into the love aspect of our lives, you know? And then the other thing, too, that especially today, Where you hear people saying, "Well, that's your truth, and this is my truth, and that's her truth." He's, okay, you know, but you know, people crave truth.
There's
only one. If I'm saying, well now, Kevin, if that makes you happy, then that's your truth. But what people, when people say that, and it sounds so enticing. Oh, yes, let's be generous here. No. What you're actually saying is there's no such thing as truth if it's just your truth.
You're denying
a real truth if it's just pick and choose whatever makes you happy, that's your truth. No. That's another element of a song.
Yeah.
If people say, "I'm hearing truth in this song," people crave truth. Call it God's truth, but the truth. And when that, like a bridge over troubled water, you know, "Hey Jude," these huge songs, people are hearing truth in there, you know, and we're attracted to truth.
Well, and I think to pick apart everyone, just to say that's your truth, is devaluing their point of view.
Yeah,
your truth, which, but, you know, I mean, and then there's always that but and that follow-up to it.
Good point.
You just kind of...
Yeah, go ahead, pal. Good luck with that. Have fun.
Exactly. Well, so now I thought I'd touch on fame. Fame is a thing that I think you hear a lot of people grappling with, especially like you were talking about earlier, where you put a lot of different stuff together. You know, they're hitting awards and Juno Awards and everything else, and they haven't even hit the stage yet. And so fame is a bit of a really, everyone rich and famous, right? They want to be famous. But that element, how do you manage it? Because, you know, we did kind of touch on it a little bit earlier off camera, but it was one that I think a lot of people have curiosity about, because you need to really, one of the things, and I know this is going to be floating your boat a little bit, but there's a lot of truth to it, is that you're a very approachable person. You're genuine, you're courteous, and then you give the respect in return when people are, you know, wanting to talk to you, and you actually kind of, you know, position your body and look at the person that you're talking to. And that's not only, I think, not what I expected, but it's also a rarity. And how do you manage that when people are wanting to talk to you and you've got to be able to delegate your time, you know, through all different things while you're in the middle of something, while at the same time kind of having a bit of a boundary for not only yourself, but then dealing with someone who seems to know way more about you. Like you're looking at a complete stranger, but they know who you are and they know all this stuff about you. And that must be a really weird, you know, dynamic and element to have to deal with. I would imagine that if you're thrown into the mix, especially with some people that are just, you know, like me, and then all of a sudden everybody on planet Earth knows who you are. You know, how do you grapple with that? Like, is this something like fame for you? Like, what is your approach and how do you manage that?
Well, thank you for saying all those nice things. Well, you said, use the word boundaries a moment ago. And, you know, I mean, it's something that society has recognized, like what healthy boundaries are. And you and I were speaking before the microphones were switched on about, in today's social networking world, again, even the audience performer relationship has a kind of a social contract to it. But that's breaking down now when you're supposed to be buddies with all your Facebook friends, you know, all 3,500 of them, you know, like, as somebody said, all these poor teenagers who were committing suicide. When I was a kid, to be popular in school meant that you had maybe four or five really good friends.
Exactly.
You'd phone each other and you'd get together on school nights and watch a certain TV show or, you know, do whatever you're doing, or in our case, playing our guitars or something. But the expectation back then was, okay, you'd have four or five core friends, and then to be really popular, there were maybe another dozen people who thought that you dress real cool, you know?
And maybe
if you were, for a guy anyway, if you were really courageous, you could walk up to that girl over there and ask her to dance. Now you're successful, you know? But as a lot of these kids have pointed out, the pressure is on to make it look in social networking as though, A, you're living an exciting life, and nobody's living an exciting life. We all have to do laundry and buy groceries, right? And B, that you have not, you know, 12 good friends or 12 friends, but 12,000 or 1,200. Like the pressure to be popular it's like a disease, and nobody can live up to it, you know? But if I'm addressing your question, I mean,
I know it's a very complicated, like there's a lot there to unpack.
There's a lot there to unpack. So now the performer audience relationship should be a healthy one as well. And as mom said, you know, good boundaries, know when to say no, you know, all that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah.
And people play good cop, bad cop, and that's what managers are for, you know, like, we'll come to your event, you know, so sorry, you know, this kind of stuff. Like you just can't say yes to everybody. But, you know, be as my mom said, be polite, that kind of stuff. But to really address that idea. I mean, thank heavens, I wouldn't want to be famous, capital F famous, you know? Like, people in the corporate world can be very well known by their peers in their industry, you know
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah.
Or somebody else, you know, a champion chess player can be very well known in that community, but that person can still walk down the street and not get recognized and can go into a store and buy a stick of gum and he's not going to get mobbed, he or she, and then you know, walk home safely, right? So, but yes, we're living in a world now where all that stuff is blown out of proportion. So, I mean, I can't imagine being famous the way Adele is famous. I mean, there are people who have to put on disguises just to walk down the street and get a walk it, to walk the dog, you know?
Yeah.
So.
But it's a weird little element because without that, they're not, that kind of level of fame is dependent on the fame itself.
Yes.
Like, for you to be famous and that, while internet globally known for yeah. like a lot of people, whether you're a superstar, you know, actor or, yeah. or artist or whatever, you've got to end up managing that in a way, because that element is actually, you're dependent on that element to be able to actually draw the income. That's the industry that you're in, mm-hmm. is having virtually everybody, as many people on planet Earth, know who you are, mm-hmm. and really value that. And so that interaction and that commitment, you know, that's got to wear on people, especially when it's a weird element that humans by nature are not very happy when they're tired. you have to be happy takes energy, right? So well, that's a very high standard to maintain, not only day to day, but like, I mean, for someone like yourself, you know, over 40 plus years in the industry of being famous and maintaining that image and that standard of interaction with people, you know, that's a hell of a skill. I mean, that's got to be almost, is it overwhelming sometimes? You're like, man, what am I doing? Or is this just something that you've managed and you're just kind of able to kind of navigate through that a lot easier? Like, that's got to be something else.
Well, yes, thank you for saying so. And I'm glad that I'm not on that insane level of, you know what I mean? I mean, again, I mean, I'm just a guy who writes and sings songs and stuff. So, I mean, when we come out and do shows, yeah, you're going to be face-to-face with your audience, you know, and just, you know, sign the T-shirts later on. And you know, people are great. You know, for everyone who thinks that they somehow have a piece of you, that's what we're talking
yeah.
about here. It's that fine line yeah. between being nice and stalking, you know,
exactly.
that
exactly
okay
yeah.
so now we're talking okay. about the dark side. But 99.99% of everybody you meet are just great, and you know, we're all human, we understand, you know, you and I have become friends here, and so I really enjoy meeting people, and everyone has a life, and they'll say, well, thanks a lot for the music or this kind of stuff, or you know my wife and I met listening to one of your albums or whatever
yeah.
it is, you know? And I think, well, thank you, because we all do that, like we're all fans of somebody else, you know, so
that's true.
So I
yeah.
have my heroes.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, I got started in songwriting because of like the people like the Beatles and stuff like that. That was my generation, right? So, I mean, you can understand all that stuff. Mm. So if somebody just says, well, you know, that song that you wrote, you know, Take Me Away or Young and Restless or whatever it is, you know, that really helped get me through a tough time, or, you know, I listen to that and, you know, I get comforted by the, you know, the assurance of the message of the lyric, and I'll say, well, thank you very much. You know, I really appreciate you saying that. And, you know, they'll probably say, well, thanks for giving me 5 minutes. See you later. You
yeah,
know,
yeah.
you know, so that's all good. And I've moved out to the country now, as you yeah. folks have done. And so it's so funny because I've only been living there for, well, I guess I'm going on 3-4 years now. But I'll go down to the local store or the local supermarket, you know, at 11 o'clock. No, they don't say open that late in the country. 9 o'clock at night, 5 to 9.
No, in the country. Yeah, they're shutting down at 4.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So at 5 to 8,
yeah.
I'll run into the you know, frozen food section or something. So, you know, as I'm taking it to the cashier, and the cashier will be checking it through, and then the person will look up and say, oh, hi, Al, love your latest record. Well, thank you. You know, and it's cool. It, like, thank you very much. I appreciate that for exactly what I'm. Thank you for listening. You know, and that's it. So people are nice and people are polite. It's cool. So, you know, coming out on tour, of course, you know, that's you're going out to meet people as well as to perform in front of them, and then you go home, and then the cashier says thanks.
So that's probably a bit of a different dynamic too, like just a headspace that you got to get into when you're on a tour. Like, you know that this is now part of the tour where you're kind of being able to delegate time, right? Yeah. Okay, this is what I need to do for the setup and the performance. There's, I'm sure, a lot of different people that are wanting parts of your time, and you need to be able to respectfully kind of manage that. And then at the same time, those people that are wanting to interact, you know, like a podcast, have to realize that there's a lot of other, you know, requirements all within one day. And you got to be able to kind of set that, those boundaries and kind of take those into consideration from one day to the next, and manage it a little bit.
Oh yeah, and you know what? That's you can extrapolate that into the traveling salesman, or, you know, or someone in a certain industry, or you know, a school teacher. You got to go to the, you know, to the meeting and stuff, and meet with your district, and you know, it's all the same thing. I mean, we all do it.
So. It's a bit of an unfair question, but I'm going to ask it anyways. Mm-hmm. Like, when it comes to a lot of those people that are kind of thrown into a way higher level of fame that we touched on earlier, I'm sure that you've seen, is there maybe something that you could speak to, like advise, say, okay, you know, now you went from a garage band, so to speak, to you're hitting a way higher level of fame. Is there something that you would say, okay, just keep in mind, whatever, like a piece of advice of some kind?
Like to keep your head, don't believe all your own good press.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, certainly. Yeah. Yeah. You have to keep your feet on the ground and remain right size. Know the difference between flattery and, you know, I mean, people should, their conscience should tell them where they're really at, you know, like you know if you've done a job well, or you know if you've kind of missed the mark, or you know you're not you know, the answer to everything. And yeah, I think as you were saying earlier, there's almost this celebrity industry, which maybe Paris Hilton started, I don't know, but yeah, the idea, don't crave fame. It that's not healthy, you know, like, because people who achieve it, they all say it's not what you thought, you know. Yeah. It's not a party, you know, and it comes with a price. And again, there's different levels of that. So yeah, I don't think it's healthy to, what was that last year, that was a couple of years ago, there was that that great hit song, Popular, right? I just want to be popular. I was pleased that my daughter could laugh at that, you know. and that, once again, that's back to, you know, craving the fame side. Yeah. If you, anybody who might be entertaining that idea out there, especially young people, sit down and think about that for a moment. You know, that's not a healthy thing to crave. So no. Just hone your skills, you know, be good at what you're doing. If people appreciate that, then you've done your job well, you know?
Yep. And then, absolutely.
And then understand.
No, that's good. That's, I think, a very, very well said, actually. That's a good thing to kind of stay focused on, because if you focus on, I think from what you were telling me, or what I heard, is if you focus on the passion that has gotten you started with it to begin with, it's probably going to be easier to manage the fame that comes along with it.
Certainly.
So manage what this is all about, and a little bit of the, this is a bad word, but this is all I have right now, but some of the symptoms or things that kind of come with it are going to be a little bit easier to be able to absorb and manage in your day-to-day life as you go.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Absolutely. Yeah. I remember this has happened more than once, but I think the most famous one was when Elvis Presley was at the peak of his success. His career was bigger than the entire entertainment industry.
Wow.
I mean, just take a moment, like for the viewers, take a moment and think about what that was just said.
Yeah.
Elvis was bigger.
Bigger than the industry
He was bigger than the music business he was in. He was bigger. And apparently at one of his shows, at the peak of all that, some of the fans up in the balcony unfurled this big banner that said, Elvis is king. And Elvis stopped the show and said, I'm not king. God is king, you know? Mm. The Lord Jesus is the King of Kings, not me. I'm just a guy that sings. He actually stopped the show and said that.
Wow.
And he was probably doing more for his sanity at that moment to say, wait a minute, you know, you're calling me the king.
He was recognizing something he wanted to kind of check to stay grounded.
Yeah.
You let that kind of roll and it becomes a bit of a monster on its own. And he wanted to kind of check it.
Yeah.
It was an opportunity to be able to kind of correct, I think, something he already had a concern about.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, it is in the moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unreal. You mentioned, you mentioned earlier, we got to bring up some stuff here because we're getting near the end, but I wanted to kind of bring this a little bit in about starting your own single, Al Harlow. Can I bring that up actually?
Thank you.
Where are we at here? There we go.
I almost forgot. My new solo album.
Your solo. No, we need to make sure that this is talked about.
Thank you.
This is your website, Al Harlow. Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Well, thanks.
This is a little bit separate from Prism, correct?
Well, it is totally separate, yeah. And way back at the beginning when we were starting this interview, before we were called Prism, we were called the Seeds of Time. We were a band before Prism. But I was always Al Harlow, the solo guy, you know? And so when we were first having our first studio experiences, I was cutting my first solo album at that point. So my band was called Harlow, Al Harlow. And I was doing it. I was out there. I was doing shows as Al Harlow, you know. And then the Seeds of Time would sort of come and go for me, like Rocket Norton and Lindsey Mitchell had the Seeds of Time with John Hall, the keyboard player. And that became the core of what we called Prism. But I was always kind of a satellite, you know, I was called in, you know, and I'd be in the band for 6 months and then I'd go off and, you know, Al. So there always was a solo Al Harlow guy.
Gotcha.
And so.
So this isn't something really new. This is something that you're just kind of get re-engaging a little bit more.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm grateful for Prism and what it has afforded me, you know, the freedom to go on doing it. Yeah. But I always felt the compulsion, or shall we say the need to say, well, no, there's another identity here. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like I'm not defined completely by Prism's music. And there's also the Al Harlow side, which of course I inject into, you know,
Prism.
I've written a number of the Prism songs.
Yeah.
So anyway, my new album is called Al Harlow Now, and we went number one in Pittsburgh, and we've charted top 20 in I think Germany and England. Yeah.
Oh, my.
So, but in today's world, as we were saying before, you know, living living our lives online. You know, the promise was that it would bring us all together. Well, in some ways it has. And has Wikipedia brought us all together? I'm not sure. But in other ways, it's allowed us to separate into our little cubicles, you know, like, okay.
All the different charts that you can reference.
Yeah, you know, so there's no mass audience anymore, you know, which is why young people now are saying, hey, come on, listen to what I'm listening to, you know, and that's what friends do for friends now. They say, I've discovered this great new singer, this great new band. So everybody still has to do it word of mouth, you know. So, but anyway, with the Al Harlow Now thing, so in other words, I'm told that it's successful, but I'm not too sure. You know, once upon a time, that meant that everybody in the whole wide world was listening to one thing. You know, so anyway, we're happy that we did it. I got a great production team. I've got my Al Harlow band. We go out and do shows and stuff like that. So I called the album Al Harlow Now. Okay, guys. This is what I'm doing right now. This is
See.
And some people say they can hear elements of Prism in it, which I say, okay, well, thank you. Because yes, there's elements of Prism.
Well, exactly. It's your fingerprint.
Yeah.
I mean, you've had your fingerprint on Prism, much like, you know, with Al Harlow Now and this album.
Yeah. So my ideas, my heart, you know, what I'm all about is in Al Harlow Now.
Yeah.
Now, next year, or once the album you know, has reached its audience. When my buddies in the Seat of Time tapped me on the shoulder and said, "Hey, we got this thing that we're forming called Prism. Let's go over and do this." I said, "Okay, sure, let's do that. You know, I'll take one for the team here." Mm. But at that moment, I was in the studio recording my first Al Harlow album. So that was in the 70s. And so those tracks are still sitting there. And I've just remixed them and remastered them. So there's an Al Harlow then. So this is the Al Harlow.
Oh, yeah. Really?
So next year I'm going to put out the archival historical, you know, Al Harlow's first solo album will come out next year.
Gotcha.
And it's back when
That's actually pretty cool.
Yeah, so it'll be like bookends. Then and now. So I put out the now first to say, okay, guys, I got a brand new album. It's me. This is me now.
Almost like Star Trek.
Yeah,
They start right in the middle, don't they?
Yeah,
yes. Hey, let's go backtrack a little bit.
Yeah, so
backstory.
That's my little plan here to say, so, you know, have people pay attention to this record and go, you know, hopefully people will like it. Then I'll tap them on the shoulder and say, oh, by the way, here, this was my first album over here. So Al Harlow then and now.
Do many people know about that?
No.
Like, I had no idea. And you mentioned Wikipedia, and I didn't know how to condense all that information in Wikipedia into something manageable.
Yeah.
And even in that, they didn't even mention, or maybe they did, but I didn't even pick up on the fact that you got Al Harlow and now you've got now.
Yes. So don't believe everything you read or don't read in Wikipedia.
Absolutely. So what kind of genre, like, what kind of music is this? I did read a little bit along the way, I don't know if I read it or maybe it was an interview I seen of you, but gospel is something that you've got a strong interest and passion for. Is that an element that you've got integrated into this album?
Oh yeah, certainly. Yeah. So, I mean, this is, you know, who I am, what I am, you know, it's guitar driven melodic rock, you know, and I've always, you know, my heart has beat for gospel music and ballads and that kind of stuff. So I think, you know, anybody could press play and they would hear straight ahead, you know, you might call it brand new classic rock, I suppose. You know what I mean? Like melodic guitar driven rock for sure. And I had a lot of guest stars too. Sean Verrault, the famous slide player, even though I'm a slide player, he's way better than me. So I had him come in and, you know, I got some guest stars in there. That's for sure. And, but yeah, when you mention gospel, some people think that that's a style of music, you know, like Southern gospel and that kind of stuff, like Al Green, so all that is true. Of course it is. But I mean, gospel music, that goes all the way back through the beginning of time, you know, I mean,
absolutely,
you know, the Anglo-Saxon, you know, deep from the British Isles, you know, the English hymnals and all the way through, you know, all the Ethiopia and stuff and, Africa, Europe and stuff, right back to the beginning of...
It touches every culture.
Every culture. And so, I mean, I was a big fan of Take Six, you know, the jazz vocals, and that was a gospel group. So when we say gospel, I remember I was sitting on an airplane beside a really lovely old lady. And she said, "What kind of music do you do?" And so I was trying to have the very same conversation that we're having here right now. And so she said it so sweetly. I could tell she was a very peaceful person. You know what I mean? Like, she had the spirit. And she said, "Okay, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this is what you're saying." And she said, "Well, the great hymns, you know, that we so universally love and that we sing at Christmas time, you know," she said, "that's what you call worship music, where everybody in the room can sing along and feel the spirit, right? Okay, that's fine. But then there's testimonial music. There's the Johnny Cash gospel. You know, you know what I mean? Like there's..."
Yeah, yeah.
And so I was so grateful for having met this. I think that was meant to be, that sitting beside this lady on the airplane. And so that really clarified it for me. I mean, Bob Dylan has done it. Bruce Coburn's done it. I mean, people are doing it these days. Yeah. They do it in country music all the time.
Yeah, they do. Yeah.
You know, so what I do is, and I couch it. I hide it in the middle of my songs. And so someone will say, "Hey, Al, in one of your songs there, are you saying what I think you're saying?" And I'll say, "Yeah, I'm a Christian, but I'm not thumping you over the head with a Bible." You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So people discover it. And so I guess they call that kind of, you know, testimonial stuff where I'll just put it in the middle of a song. Like there's a song on my new record. Well, there's several actually, but you have to go and find it. But there's one called He Don't Live Here No More. And it's on the surface, it's a song about addiction, but it's also a song about salvation and rescue, which happens at the end of the song. There's a happy ending, right?
And you took something that you're able to relate. We talked about that when it comes to the, I guess, the how do you write a song? And you're actually taking a lot of your perspectives and how you, your outlooks on things, and you just turned it right into, you incorporated it into your music.
Yeah, yeah. Tell the truth, brother.
That's pretty cool.
And there's a couple more too. There's one called Meet Me in the Sky. And we joke about this because, like, say, my band, Prism, we come from all over the place, and I'm the leader. I book the flights, as we were talking earlier.
Yeah.
So I got to bring these guys in from all these airports and get them to where we're going, you know? And so we all end up on the same flight, but we all started off at different airports. So we laugh because we say hello, good morning, and shake hands at 35,000 feet. So, you know, meet me in the sky is literally, I'll see you on the airplane, you know?
And
so,
gotcha.
So there's a spiritual aspect to that. So, you know, so I put that into, there's a song on there called Meet Me in the Sky. So you can see where the idea started. It was kind of a joke, but I turned it into the rapture. I turned it into a heavenly, you know, thing. And then there's another song too called Dance with the One You Came With. Now, I saw that in an email, and there's a story behind that, and we may, don't have time, but I was allowed into an email loop with my agent, you know, and somebody else was trying to steal the band to go book us at, with some promoter at some festival. And the guy who was running the festival said, my motto is always dance with the one you came with. In other words, I'm going to stay loyal to my agent and the guy that first brought me this band. So I was reading this in an email, and the words, that title just exploded. Boom. Dance with the one you came with. And the song, I wrote the song. It took me about 10 minutes to write the song after reading that.
It just captured obviously something, and you're like, oh, now I have the wording and the ability, the structure on being able to write it and capture that moment.
Yep. So on the surface, I'm giving the plot away now, but if somebody gets the album and listens to my song, Dance with the One You Came With, it sounds like a really pleasant, it rocks, the whole thing rocks. So it sounds like a really melodic, pleasant rock song, and it's about a kid growing up and, okay, you know, dance with the one you came with, and there's a literal dance in there, you know, like a high school dance. But then you listen one level further, and it's also, you know, the old thing, like, I came into this world naked, and I'm going to leave it naked.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, eternally dance with the one who brought you here. You know?
And everybody, I think, is able to take that as far as the meaning that they can relate to the most.
Exactly. Now, we're going right back there again. You know, is it something that people can take to where they live, you know?
You know what would be interesting? I don't think many people do, or maybe they do. I'm not aware of it. But wouldn't it be cool if you're able to kind of break down the origins and the meanings and everything you just described for each song?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
Like that would be, so you know how America's Got Talent, usually everybody that comes out there, you know, they do a presentation, but really what has the meaning is always the backstory.
Oh, yeah.
It's almost like the performance comes secondary to the backstory, and that's what people are able to relate, and it captures everyone's attention.
Yeah.
I bet you there'd be a lot of really, there'd be some strong interest with the backstory for each one of the songs that you end up writing. If you're able to write the, I don't know, just a short little thing for it, people would find that interesting, wouldn't they?
Yeah. And you're making a great point, because we're living in the era of the backstory, right?
It is, exactly.
Everyone wants to see, people want to see not only the movie, but the making of.
Exactly. Behind the scenes. Exactly.
and we're getting back to truth again. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, okay, tell us, well, what was the diamond in the middle of all this,
and
how did all this come together? And I'm a big fan of that. We all are, you know. Yeah.
Well, we are. I don't want to be pushing things. It sucks that we have to bring it all to an end here, because I think we are all on a roll. But I want to touch on a few things here before we move on past a couple other things here. this website, just for the viewer, especially anybody that is mm-hmm. listening right now, I'm going to put this website in the show notes.
Oh, thank you.
Also, it's just alharlow.com, isn't it, for them to find it?
Yeah, and we've got it on both black vinyl and colored vinyls, limited edition, and downloads. So alharlow.com is where you can buy the hardware, you know, CDs, vinyl, all that stuff. And it's on Spotify and iTunes and all.
That's where they find the music.
All the platforms, all the downloads and the streaming and all that kind of stuff, yeah.
Awesome.
And so, yeah, thank you very much. And then we've got
Prism here. This is another website for the band, just prism.ca. This is a .ca, which is cool because it's the Canadian.
We're Canadian.
I love it. I love the part that you actually have it as the .ca part.
And what we're seeing right there is what we call a day at the office.
Just on stage, performing, the crew. If you scroll down here, it was kind of neat because there's upcoming tour dates that you've got listed on the website. So if anyone's curious about that. Is there anything, look at, there's bios we can go through. Oh man, we should have brought this up earlier, but there's all kinds of information here, isn't there?
Yes. And we're always updating that stuff. Yeah.
Well, so this is a very well-maintained website.
Well, I hope so. Yeah. We're trying to
help. So
trying to keep up with the ongoing story.
The other thing too, well, this will be in the show notes, but the other thing I wanted to bring up too is the Lido Theater. That's where you played last night, and then you're going to be playing again tonight.
Yes.
And the Lido in Fort St. John, this is the third time, I guess, that you've performed in this venue. And down here you can see we're March 31st and April 1st, April Fool's Day, which is today.
Yes, happy April Fool's.
Absolutely.
But we really are playing there. We're not fooling.
And to follow up with this, today is the actual, I guess, announcement. And I touched base with Brian to get his approval on this, even though this is going to be aired afterwards. But Brian Kirshner and his wife Cindy are going to be selling the Lido Theater.
Yes.
So that's kind of a... It's a sad thing because he's had such a huge role in Fort St. John and touched so many different artists. I mean, yesterday watching you kind of go through some of those posters that have performed at the Lido Theater, and you were able to, you know, make a lot of different connections. You said, man, there's like, look, all my friends have been here. So, you know, they've really touched, I think, not only the people in this area. You know, a beacon of light and entertainment is part of their statements on their website, but also, you know, making sure that, you know, they're supporting a lot of the different artists that are coming, the up and comers, right, to people that have been around for a while, comedians and hypnotists and, you know, musicians and whatnot. So if anyone is interested in the Lido Theater, I don't know, you know, if by the time you see this, the sales have taken place, but it's bittersweet. So, and I hope you know, in the future, we'll be seeing you out here again.
Well, I
this
hope
has
so
been
too.
A hell of a good time.
I hope so too. And yes, Brian and his wife have done an exemplary job of making the Lido Theater into a very special place. I mean, it's a hub of the community. They just brought in great artists and causes, and it's hard to believe 16 years of dedication has paid off. I mean, it's the Lido Theater is famous, and what a thrill that we're here on the announcement night, the 16th anniversary.
Oh boy, oh boy. If that crowd there seemed like last night, you had them going pretty good. I mean, that venue. One of the things yesterday when I was on stage is I was always looking up at the stage. What I didn't realize is looking down, you can see virtually every single person in that room, can't you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Isn't that unreal? I always thought we were kind of, you know, we're in the back, they can't see us. That's not accurate at all. You can see every single person, can't you, from that stage.
It's sometimes
something else.
When they bring the house lights up for a moment, you know, oh, okay, there's what's going on in the far corner. But the crowd were just wonderful, just great folks here.
I'm going to show one more thing. Here, this is some photos that I took of last night.
There we are.
This is pretty cool. Let's see here. Where's my mouse? There should be a little arrow that points you.
Mm-hmm. To the next.
Oh, there we go. There we go. Let's bring this up a little bit.
Yeah. There we are.
There you are.
Yeah, my weightlifting.
That's awesome.
Uh-oh. I call that my monkey on a Look stick routine.
This is kind of cool.
Yeah.
I like that with, you know, you had a standing ovation and this kind of captured that. I don't know when this was taken, but throughout the whole night, you had people up right on the dance floor, just about every song. There you go, the guitar. So is this a little bit of a trademark maneuver?
It's become that. Can I tell all of our viewers?
Absolutely.
A little secret?
Sure.
So that's it. That's at the end of the night.
Yeah.
And it takes a minute or two. You can see that our drummer Gary Grace up on the drums stand behind me there.
Oh, let's go back.
And it takes him a couple of minutes to get down from the drum stand.
Oh.
And so that's my way of killing time.
Oh, really? It's the visual cue.
Yeah.
Come on down here.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah. And then Mark on the stage left with his keyboards. He has to shut down his.
Well, here's a short video. So this is right after that shot of you with the guitar up.
Yeah.
And this is with all the band members in front. That's
our little final bow sort of thing. So our keyboard player has to shut down his computer and do all that. And there's me acting like a ham bone as we say goodnight. And so, yeah.
That was good.
So, yeah, the bench pressing the guitar is my way of giving Gary a chance to get down from his drum.
Very riser. Cool. Behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Right on.
The backstory.
The backstory. Well, sir, I'm going to play one last little song here on our out. Should have done this earlier. This is Armageddon.
I know that one.
Yeah, I think you might be pretty familiar with this, won't you? And on the way out, I just want to say thanks again. I do appreciate your time and for you to be a part of this. This is amazing. I'm really actually excited that I was able to meet you and actually talk to you, you know, for this length of time and in such detail. And I hope to stay in touch and have you on the Unscripted Experience again.
Well, thank you very much, Kevin. And thanks for having me on the show. And thanks to everybody out there. And we'll see everybody real soon.
Sounds good. Take care, guys. We'll see you.